Hello and welcome to The Culture Show. Thank you so much for your company. Our special guest on the show today is Tom Sweeney, and he'll be regaling us with stories and some songs also. And of course, we're delighted to have Danny McCormick on bass with his two shiny shoes. We're going to kick off now with just the two of us. Shining through to make those rainbows in my mind. When I think of you sometimes, I want to spend some time with you, just the two of us. We can make it if we try, just the two of us, just the two of us. Tears, wasted waters, all that is, and it don't make no flowers grow. Good things might come to those who wait, not for those who wait too late. We gotta go for all we know, just the two of us. We can make it if we try, just the two of us, just the two of us, just the two of us. Build them castles in the sky, just the two of us, you and I. Crystal raindrops fall on the window down the hall, and it becomes the morning dew. And darling, when the morning comes and I see the morning sun, I wanna be the one with you, just the two of us. We can make it if we try, just the two of us, just the two of us. Just the two of us, building big castles in the sky. Just the two of us, you and I. Just the two of us, we can make it if we try. Just the two of us, just the two of us, just the two of us, building.
Let me be. I said, now baby, have some mercy.
every single night, hoping you'll return and make things right. You don't show, and I'm sitting here to pray you're gonna call me on the phone. Baby, have some mercy, please. Don't make your mama beg on bended knees. Oh, please, mercy, mercy, mercy. Once more.
Tom Sweeney has some mercy on us. We're going to join him now for a chat. So, Mr. Tom Sweeney, you're very welcome to the Culture Show.
Thank you, Gerda and Bob. It's nice to be here. In fact, it's nice to be anywhere.
Well, well, the alternative isn't very attractive, actually.
After the lockdown, it's great to be out.
Yeah,
and
totally.
Mingling again.
Yeah. And that would have affected you greatly.
Well, like yourself. Like all musicians, you know, it was tough. You spend 40 years on the road every day, and all of a sudden you're sitting in the house like Silas Marner looking out the window, you know.
Yeah,
that's awful. But I think there's an appreciation from people now to have live music and even to be out together.
That's right, I just realised during lockdown the importance of live music to people's lives, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's so vital.
Yeah, absolutely.
Or music in general.
Yeah, during lockdown I used to applaud the NHS every Thursday, I think it was.
At 6 o'clock.
I used to go out on my front outside the house to put up my speakers, and I would do a half an hour of songs just for the neighbours.
Yeah, yeah.
And you know, that was the time of real lockdown when no one could go anywhere, and the place would be packed.
Yeah.
And they'd bring their chairs and sit around, you know.
Yeah.
I get up and do a half an hour and then lead the applause.
Brilliant. But
it was great.
Yeah.
Because people, I felt, needed it, you know.
Yes,
but great for you as well. Great for you.
Oh, it was great to get singing, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah.
Absolutely. Might have been good for them, but it was good for me.
Well, as long as it worked for you, that's all that matters. So, Where did it start then? Your music and your folklore and your stories.
Well, the music started with my family. My father was a like Bob was a brass player. He would have joined St. Eugene's band as a very young boy and played cornet, and then went on to French horn. And my mother's family were the Makehams from County Armagh, Kerry. My grandmother,
as in Tommy Makeham.
Uh huh.
Brilliant.
My maternal grandmother Sarah Makeham was a what they call in folklore a source singer. In other words, she had so many songs that folklorists would come from all over the world to her house. You know, I remember one time my mother and I went to visit her, and there was a man and his wife in the house. It must be a terraced house in Kerry, and this is back in the early 60s maybe, and this woman had a cine camera, and she was following my grandmother around the house, and she would sing and bake bread and sing and everything. And the man, he was talking away, and they left anyway. And I said to my grandmother, who's that man? Oh, I don't know. She's, it's somebody that Tommy Makeham sent over from America. And his card, Pete Seeger.
Really? Wow.
And his wife, Tommy had said to them, they were very friendly in America because of the folk boom in the Greenwich Village in the 1960s. If you're in Ireland, call and see my mother, and he did.
Yeah.
And did your, shocked, you know? Did your granny realise what a source of information?
No, not at all.
Isn't that amazing?
I mean, a great story. She was very famous for singing these very long, obscure ballads, which she had got from her mother. And a great story when she was in her dying throes, I guess, Liam Clancy called to see her. And he was heading off on a tour the next day, and he knew he wouldn't see her again. He said, Sherry, will you give us a song? And he was expecting some old ballad, and she sang Alexander's Ragtime Band. And to her, that was as relevant
as
Barbara Allen or some of the old long
And Tom, all these songs then, they were all just oral traditions. I mean, it wasn't written down. She's had a fantastic memory.
Her recall, she's the best I ever seen. I mean, I don't know, she could remember anything. Well, and these big, I was telling you a story about one time she told me there was some travelling ballad singer. You know, in the old days, up to the 1940s really, Ireland was full of, I remember them in the hill, travelling ballad singers. I remember the last of them, an old man with a salt and pepper beard, he had a gabardine coat tied with cord, and he would stand at the bottom of our street with his hand to his ear, and his big song was Martha, Rambling Rose of the Wildwood. But he was the last of the ballad singers. But she told me this ballad singer came to Katie, and he was singing at the market house out in the street, and she knew this guy had the song that she wanted, and she said to me, I knew if I could hear the song once and get back to my house without talking to anyone, I could remember the song in its entirety.
Wow.
She was like a sponge, absorbed everything.
Yeah, that's amazing.
And the ballad singers, then what, did people throw them coins? I mean,
but they also sold what they called ballad sheets.
Oh, right, okay, yes.
You know, I mean, in the old days, that's how the news spread from town to town. The ballad guys would hear a story about a murder or whatever, and then they'd write a song about it.
Okay.
And they would print it up and go and sing it in the next town and sell the song.
Yes.
And were they selling the song or were they selling the news?
Both.
Okay.
And they were called, they cost a penny, and they were called penny ballad sheets.
Jeez.
And that was a very important source of news in rural Ireland back before.
Yeah. Well, radios and things.
Telecommunications.
Yes,
like busking.
Sure.
Yeah. It was. Yeah. And they just travelled from town to town.
Yeah,
making a living like that.
And if people like your granny were listening to these songs and learning them, presumably that's where you would get the variation, that by the time it reached five or six
people,
there'd be
wee changes here and there, that's right. And they wrote nothing down, and the tune was negotiable. I mean, you just sang, if the ballad singer, he would write the words of the local news, but he would sing it to some tune that everyone knew.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
Yeah. In order that they could learn it quickly as well.
Yes.
I mean, I have books in the house full of old ballad sheets, penny ballad sheets.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
Amazing. So, where did your career then kick off?
Well, my brother Jimmy and I began singing at local concerts when we were, I think I was 9, he was 11, I think.
Wow.
And a man called Paddy Mossy, God be good to him, he was a local butcher, but he was a comedian, and he had a concert troupe. And we were part of it, and we play every parochial hall in Northern Ireland in Sunday nights concerts.
Yeah.
Orange halls and parochial halls, and there were 5 or 6 in the troupe, and we were a full concert, and we just began to learn songs. And because my uncle Tommy was in America, mm-hmm. he was in the middle of the Clancy Brothers, and Tommy became a huge, yeah. huge act.
Yeah, sure.
And I remember going to Royal Arms to see Makeham and Clancy
yeah.
with Mummy and Daddy,
uh-huh.
And sure. they were in their iron jumpers.
Oh, goodness.
And I mean, I wasn't old.
No.
Yeah.
And in the front row, and I remember it so clearly.
Yeah.
And I remember I was so delighted because I was so close. You know, and like you were really close to someone who yeah. was really famous.
Yeah, and they were great. They were.
I know the feeling.
Thank you. I think.
And because I suppose because of the fact that Tommy was in the middle of this whole, what yeah. they call the folk scare, in the Greenwich Village with the Kingston Trio, mm-hmm. Peter, Paul, and Mary, when Bob Dylan first came from Minnesota to New York, his name was Robert Zimmerman, and Paddy Clancy had a recording company. Called Tradition Records, and he would tape. He would go taping old blues singers in the Mississippi
yeah.
Delta,
okay, yeah.
and he would record Ewan McCall singing Scottish border ballads.
Yeah.
And Paddy had a good company. When Bob Dylan came to New York, Bob worked for Paddy in the office. And if you notice Bob Dylan's first few albums, a lot of the tunes are Irish tunes.
Yeah.
And he wrote new words to them, you know.
Yeah.
And so Tommy was in the midst of all this stuff, and he kept sending us. Long playing records, which you couldn't get here, of all the sort of popular folk people in the United States,
yes.
Seeger, we would learn loads of these songs, okay. you know, and sing them.
Right.
So that was great.
Right. And then did you think, I got to go out there?
Well, I used to work in the library
okay.
in Omaha here, and I was sitting one day in the library and I thought to myself, you know, I could sit here forever and no one would tell me to leave.
Yeah,
and then my brother Jimmy was teaching in the high school here, and we decided we would leave our jobs. And my mother was a widow in those days with 9 kids, and these were the jobs with a pension.
A government job,
pension, you know. We didn't realise that, so we both resigned the same day, which was unheard of yeah. for a teacher to resign.
Your brother was a teacher in St. Pat's.
He was,
wasn't
yeah.
It?
And yeah. he just said, "We're leaving." And we were walking home, and Jimmy said to me, you better tell my mother this. I said, why would I tell her? You're the eldest, you tell her. You
yeah.
know? We walked home, and Jimmy said, Mammy, we have someone to tell you here. And I said, what's that? He said, me and him have just left our jobs. And she goes, what? What are you going to do? Jimmy foolishly said, we're going to sing. My mother said, who the hell ever told you you could sing? And then Tommy Makin was very kind, and we phoned Tommy and we said, we've left our job. He said, you bloody idiots. But he had contacts in America and he got us
and
jobs.
And were you married then?
Oh, no.
No, so you were going out to...
That was great, yeah. I was maybe telling you, there were four clubs, this is about 1969, maybe, 70. There were four clubs, they all had the same name, there's a chain. Very good clubs were called the Harp and Bard, and there were four of them in various cities outside Boston, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And you'd play them on a circuit. At the same time, playing them was Billy Connolly. He wasn't
okay.
he wasn't well known.
No,
Jerry
sure.
Rafferty
yeah,
was playing
okay,
there.
Yeah.
Paddy Riley, Danny Doyle, Sands family. They were all play. We all
yeah,
played
yeah.
these clubs
yeah, yeah.
in Massachusetts. And then the guys, they were owned by a consortium. And then one of the guys in the consortium, a man called Michael Broadbine, he decided... He would open an Irish music club in Nashville. And he opened this club called the Tarlet Club on the Nashville Broadway in 1974.
Mm-hmm.
And he asked us, would we be the house band for 6 months? We went off to Nashville. And because it was a new thing, you know, in Nashville, this Irish club, and everyone came. Johnny Cash and
yeah,
Buck
okay.
Owens and
yeah.
Bill Monroe. Every night people, because they wanted to know what was going on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then... they realised quickly that a lot of these old songs we were singing, they were American country songs, which had come from these old songs, and they were written in a new vein.
Yeah, okay.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
This was the source song, and they had American versions of them.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And then somebody twigged, God, these
yes.
are the old Irish versions of the songs we sing.
We sing, yeah,
mm-hmm.
yeah. There was a brilliant RTE series many, many years ago called Bringing It All Back Home.
I know it very well,
and
yeah.
that was exactly what you talked about.
Exactly,
tracing
yeah.
Yeah.
And then Bill Monroe, who was, they call the father of bluegrass, he began to realise that a lot of the tunes, I played the whistle and John Doherty played the fiddle, and we would play Irish jigs and reels, and he would know versions from Kentucky of the same tune, you know.
Yeah, I get it.
And he would get up on the stage with a big cowboy hat and he would play along with us. It was
yeah.
great for a young
yeah, yeah.
man, you
yeah,
know.
Yeah.
It was really brilliant, you know.
Yeah. yeah. yeah.
Was that you remember one of the stories you told us? Was that Nashville or Texas when some big man came up and asked you to play him a request?
Some of the requests you get are very strange. This man came in, we were playing somewhere, I don't know where it was, Boston or somewhere, and he was from Texas or somewhere, and he said, excuse me, y'all, I like y'all to sing for me Old Man River. And I said, Old Man River? Yeah, Old Man River. Well, I said, well, we don't sing Old Man River. You sure do. I heard y'all sing it last night. And I said, you're in the wrong place. We don't sing Old Man River. I heard y'all sing it.
Was he scary?
I said, well, how does it go? He goes, and it's Old Man River.
No, nay, never.
Another good story about that song is we used to, our band was called Barley Bree, and we were very lucky. We got a television series in Canada. We had two or three of them, but the first one we got, and it was because it was shown in British Columbia on the Canadian West Coast. They also got it in Alaska.
Okay.
So the Alaskan Arts Council would invite us up to do a tour in Alaska, you see.
Thank God.
And you would do three theatres in the cities, Anchorage, Fairbanks, and Juneau. And then for the fourth concert, you would go to the Inuit reservation.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And do a concert for them.
Yeah.
So we arrived at the reservation on maybe a Sunday afternoon, and the head honcho, oh, great to meet you. We see you every Wednesday on the TV, blah, blah, blah. I want you to play a very special request for my wife tonight in the concert. And I said, sure, what is it? You know, her favorite song is No Nay Never. I said, really? Oh, of course, we'll do it. He says, you know, she likes that song so much. Our dog had pups last month, and she called the pups No, Nay, and Never.
No way. Really?
True. You couldn't make it up.
Oh, my God. Brilliant. So how long were you in Canada then?
We lived in Canada almost 20 years.
My God. And, you know, whenever you say Billy Connolly was on the scene then and Johnny Cash used to pop in and that sort of thing, even though Billy Connolly wasn't well known at that time, were you aware that you were mixing?
Well, not Billy Connolly. At that time, he had a band called the Humble Bums, he and Jerry Rafferty.
Yeah.
And they were playing a lot of the sort of the folk music scene, you know. Oh, when Cash came in, it was unbelievable. I mean, I have a picture in the house. And then one time he invited us to his house for tea.
My God.
I've got a photograph in the house of... he was doing a recording for... there's a big television program takes place in America every September. Not now, but used to. They called the Jerry Lewis... You know Jerry Lewis, the comedian? The Jerry Lewis Telethon.
Okay.
And it's a 24-hour television spectacular where they would raise money for muscular dystrophy.
Okay.
And everybody, who was anybody, was in that show. So Johnny Cash was recording his segment in a studio in Nashville. But the sound man in the studio was a man called Eddie Green, who used to come and hear us playing and play the bass with us sometimes. He said, you know, come down to the studio tomorrow. Johnny Cash is recording. I said, really? Sure. And we went down. There was Johnny and June and Carr Perkins playing guitar. And we were introduced. He said, oh, yeah, I saw you guys in the club last week. What are you doing? You guys like tea, don't you? Yeah. And come out to the house for tea. And it was just amazing. We had this photograph in the house of Johnny Cash.
Good stuff.
My God.
Good stuff.
I saw it all just, I'm sure it was glamorous as well.
You know, we were very young. I mean, when I look back on it now, I'm so privileged.
Yeah.
I mean, but you didn't know it at the time.
No, sure.
It was all great fun, you know.
Yeah.
Have you ever written any of this down?
My wife keeps telling me I write some of these memoirs.
Or even record them, you know, or have them videoed or that sort of thing. I mean, these are stories that I
nothing, get, nothing gets past her, does it?
For longer than, obviously, we are here. I would have no doubt that you have more stories than we're going to hear, Tom.
Oh,
thank you very much, Bob.
It's nice being here.
Okay.
And we're going to hear you sing a song now.
One of my favourite songs of all time.
You'll Never Know.
How much I
Here's Tom
you.
Sweeney with You'll Never Know.
You'll never know just how much I miss you. You'll never know just how much I care. And if I tried, I still couldn't hide my love for you. You ought to know, for haven't I told you so. A million or more times you went away and my heart went with you. I speak your name in my every prayer. If there is some other way to prove that I love you, I swear I don't know how. You'll never know if you don't know now. My heart went with you. I speak your name in my every prayer. If there is some other way to prove that I love you, I swear I don't know how. You'll never know if you don't know now. You'll never know if you don't know now. You'll never know if you don't know.
Lovely Tom, we'll be chatting to you again later. This is Morning.
Thank you.
That was lovely. And that's not the first time you have performed or sung a song with Mr. Paul Maguire. Or we sometimes refer to him as Dr.
Dr. Maguire. Well, Paul and I were neighbours growing up, you know. We lived opposite each other.
Right.
And, I didn't know that. Right.
Okay. As a matter of fact, when I was a young fellow, Paul's grandfather, Mick, had a fruit and vegetable shop in John Street. And behind the shop, he had a sort of a shed. And I used to work on the Saturday for Paul's grandfather, filling... He had a little yellow van with an open back. Mm-hmm. And he drove around the country selling fruit and veg, you know. Yeah. So I would pack the crates in this store at the back of his house. Uh-huh. And we were just saying the other night, every time I smell like a rotten orange or... Yeah. I think of Mick Gorman's Paul's grandfather shared the back of the house. Right. You know?
Yeah. Have you any stories you could tell us about Paul?
They're not printable.
Oh, really? Right.
Once the cameras go off, Tom, you can give us the details.
I can give you the
fantastic
dirt then.
Yeah. Now, picking up from your performance, how amazing was it to go to the White House and sing for the American president, Bill Clinton?
It was totally amazing.
And at the time of history, I mean, Northern Ireland was making history.
Well, that's why I was asked, I think. I had written this song. As you know, I have a great interest in children and their well-being, and I had written this song at the height of the Troubles, mm-hmm. Just wishing a better space for both communities and their, especially the children, to find room to grow and nurture each other, you know. I wrote this song called Anthem for the Children, and at the time I was recording for a company in New York called Shanachie Records. They were a big trad label, and Bill and Hillary Clinton were in New York at some, I guess, Irish gala or something, and they were playing this song in the background, you know. And Hillary heard it, the words, listen to the words of that song. They wouldn't know me from a hole in the ground, but listen to the words of that song. Get that guy to come and sing it, you know. So I get this call from the FBI in my house. Hi, a big voice. Hi, this is the FBI. Are you Tom Sweeney? What do you want with me? You write a peace song for the children of Ireland? No, I did indeed. Well, he said that the president and the first lady have heard it and they want you to come to the White House on St. Patrick's Day because we're having all the politicians from the north of Ireland and south of Ireland, America and England, they're all going to be there. And we're sort of knocking heads together for the Good Friday Agreement, mm-hmm. and we think it would be great if you sang this song to further it along, you know.
Yep.
So it was amazing. And then...
And this was you on your own.
Mm-hmm.
That's fantastic.
So I said to them, you know, and they ask you all these questions, your wife, if your wife's coming with you, her parents' names and your own parents and what their maiden name and all this stuff for clearance, you see. So I said to the guy, well, you know, I said, you know, I'm playing at an Irish festival on West Palm Beach the night before. Oh, he said, that'd not be a problem. We'll send a plane for you.
Hello.
And they did, and up we went. And it was amazing, you know, we were... They met us at the airport, this big limo, these two guys, real FBI, dark glasses and suits and an earpiece. And, and they didn't speak to us at all. You know, this guy kept talking into his watch. And then we arrived at the hotel. This is a place called the St. James's Suites beside the White House. And it was so palatial. And I was wearing a pair of jeans or something. You know, I could see this woman behind the desk looking at me, you know. Maybe she thought I was a plumber or something. You know? And I got to the desk. She goes, yes. I said, yes. She goes, are you staying here? I said, yes. You are? What's your name? I said, Mr. Sweeney. Wait there a moment. Okay. And she went through all the stuff. She goes, Mr. Sweeney, you are staying here. Who's paying for this? I said, look and see. And I said, the office of the President of the United States. She goes, Mr. Sweeney, how lovely to see you. But it was a good experience. And then that night, I sang the peace song, and my old friend Frank McCourt from Limerick, the novelist, did a reading from Angela's Ashes. It was just great, you know.
Yeah.
Very exciting.
Part of it.
Yeah, very exciting. And my mother became insufferable. She wouldn't talk to the neighbours. I'm only joking.
I just can't imagine it. And then you went on to cruises, mm-hmm. which I also think sounds very...
That's great.
Just just, I was saying to Bob, actually, it was something when I had finished college, you know, and we had no ties or anything like that with my pals. It was something that we talked about, you know, but I don't think any of the group that I was with, I don't think any of us went to do it.
All right.
But you still do cruises.
We do. We're back. They were all cancelled during lockdown, mm-hmm. obviously, but we're doing back at them this September. We're doing a
brilliant
10 days in the Mediterranean.
And a great way to see the world.
But it's great. I mean, yeah. Right. These cruises, I've been doing them for about 25, 30 years now, and we do a couple a year. One goes to the Caribbean, then the Mediterranean, and then every other year we go up to Alaska out of Seattle.
Yes.
But they're all, it's like folk music. You see, there are all sorts of different cruises. Dominic and the guys do a show band cruise, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We do a folk cruise. They pack with people.
Yeah.
And you could have Mary Black or, I don't know, Wolf Tones, or you could make them in Clancy and mm-hmm. Francis Black and all the, you know.
Yes.
And Cherry's the Ladies and all the trad bands yes. that go out there. And it's a fabulous time. Mm. So, yeah, Bermuda. And funny, I was in Bermuda one time, walking down the street. This guy shouted at me, Tom Sweeney. He was from Omaha.
No way.
And yeah. Hamilton, Bermuda.
Small
one. Yeah, one of the Charltons of Charlton's Garage. I couldn't believe it. It's just
oh.
in the middle of yeah. Bermuda. Yeah, yeah. Okay. You know, you can go nowhere.
Not even the Bermuda Triangle. well, when you're on the cruises, then, it's not just adults only. There's going to be families and all that sort of stuff.
There are some. Well, it's mainly adults, you know. But if there are kids there, I would do a few kids' songs as well for them. But I do a lot. My act is like, I do a lot of ballads and singing and sing-alongs, and then I would tell stories and I would do quite a bit of poetry and stuff. I have a whole album out of poems and stuff as well.
Any favourites?
Ah, so many of them.
Yeah.
Just you know, Yeats, When You Were Old and Grey and Full of Sleep and Nodding by the Fire. Take down this book and dream of the soft look your eyes had once and of their shadows deep. How many loved your moments of glad grace or loved your beauty with love false or true. But one man loved the pilgrim soul in you and loved the sorrows in your changing face. And then, bending down beside the glowing bars, murmur a little sadly how love fled and paced upon the mountains overhead and hid his face amidst a crowd of stars. That's it.
Wow.
One of my favourite poems.
You've obviously inherited your mum's ability to retain words and tunes and all that sort of thing.
And I can't remember where I left my socks.
Oh, well, so that's okay. And I did ask you when we were chatting earlier, you know, if you had a favourite genre of music, and you just couldn't choose. You just
I love classical music, and for me, when I did work in the library, I was hired as a cataloging. See, when the library began to bring in gramophone records, mm-hmm. you know, I was mm-hmm. hired to classify them all.
Yeah, right.
And a man called Bill McCubry, a brilliant librarian, had devised a system for an Omaha library here. It's been used now everywhere. Of classifying all genres of music for library purposes.
Mm-hmm.
So we would buy thousands of albums and then I would classify them. It's a great job because, I mean, I had a record player in my room and stacks floor to ceiling of long playing records, every genre. And I would just play music all day long.
Yeah. Brilliant.
And then all the people who worked in the library break time will come to my office, just have a party, drink a coffee, put in requests, you know.
Yeah.
Play Mozart there and put it on, you know.
Prime ministers have been sacked for less, Tom.
mm-hmm.
Good Bob.
Well, then that led, or rather, what led you then to realising, do you know what, kids are perhaps not being catered for as much as they could be, or maybe exposed to as much music and influence.
I always had a good interest in children's songs, even as a boy, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I had all the great collections and all the great seminal recordings of children's songs, and all the great books of Peter Ropey's brilliant book on the folklore of children. I've studied that greatly. And I always knew a lot of children's songs. But I saw a guy on TV when I lived in Canada. His name was Raffi. He's huge in Canada. He's a brilliant performer.
Mm-hmm.
Just he and the guitar. But he had this beautiful way of connecting with children, and with his personality and his songs. And I was just hooked on this. My children were too.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we used to watch him on TV. Oh my God, you know. One man the guitar.
Yeah.
But he had the magic. Whatever, that ingredient X, but you can't put a finger on.
Yeah.
And he could like go to the Roy Thompson Hall in Toronto or Carnegie Hall in New York and do three shows a day sold out. Him on the guitar.
Yeah.
I thought, you know, in Ireland, these children don't get that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And I knew all the songs.
Yeah.
So I said, I'm going to try this. So a friend of mine, Gabriel Donohue, who owned a studio in Stamford, Connecticut, and I went down and I recorded an album of 20 children's songs. I came back home and I sent a copy of it, I was telling you that a copy to every school in Northern Ireland with over 100
yeah.
pupils. I said, you know, if you're interested in me coming to sing these songs yeah. for the children, I'd be yeah. very happy to do it.
Yeah.
And it was absolutely inundated. And
yeah.
then that was 30 years ago.
Yeah.
And we were saying also the way that music has changed for children in these times that we're in now, because it's very much here's a phone, here's
yeah.
an iPad, and we're all, although we're all getting older, we all sort of feel younger.
Yeah.
So there's not so much children being bounced on their granny's knees
no.
and sung wee songs.
Yeah.
And I'm sure you know,
absolutely.
Like me, I'd be in schools with the Education Board, and I'm always amazed. There are some kids that don't know the standard nursery rhymes.
Mm-hmm. Very few
They've
of them. They aren't taught anymore, you know.
But they're not heard at home.
That's right.
No.
You know, where they would have been.
That's right.
You know, when I was a child, when we were all children.
Yes, right.
So I can imagine the schools absolutely just eating this up.
Well, I have an album of, I did it purposely for that reason. I have an album called Tom Sweeney Sings 45 Nursery Rhymes. I
yeah.
just put tunes to them, all the Gary's tunes. And,
yes.
And the children love it, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
But you've also worked songs that, you know, with the alphabet and
yeah.
numbers and...
It's a great song I do sometimes. I was trying to find a song for years about the birds and the bees, you know, boys
yeah.
and girls. You know,
yeah.
And I found this great song and it goes, oh, there's two kinds of seagulls, he-gulls and she-gulls. He-gulls like she-gulls, and that's why there's seagulls. And there's two kinds of pythons, girl thorns and guy thorns. Girl thorns like guy thorns, and that's why they're pythons. And there's two kinds of wombats, dad bats and mom bats. Dad bats dig mom bats, and that's why there's wombats. And there's two kinds of squirrels, himmels and hurls. Himmels are nuts about hurls, and that's why they're squirrels.
Oh, that's goes, brilliant.
Most creatures come in pairs, that's the way they mingle. One kind only would be lonely. It takes two to tingle. And there's two kinds of blackbirds, jillbirds and jackbirds. Jillbirds like jackbirds, and that's why there's blackbirds. And on,
excellent. Excellent.
But you see, that brings in the adults as well, you know, which is why your shows are always packed.
Yeah.
And you now have to decide, look, I'm not working 5, 6, 7 days a week.
That's what I'm doing right now. I do about...
Yeah.
Tops 3. I was doing Sundays at various private things. I was doing Saturdays, and I mean, I just had to stop it, you know.
Yeah.
My phone rings nearly every single day for years when they play a birthday party.
That is brilliant.
I just don't do it.
Yeah.
I could not do it. So, time for a plug here.
Good.
I just finished, as a matter of fact, it's with Spotify right now on iTunes. It'll be out next week. An album of 20 birthday party songs for children.
Brilliant.
Well, that'll be out next week.
Okay.
And have you ever done like the songs and a DVD? You know, I think that would be great for schools, because
I did a folk DVD on location around Ireland, different places. I've never done a kids one, you know. You know, I don't know. I just think sometimes it's hard to capture the moment, you know.
Yeah.
There's a certain thing happens when you're on stage with children, and I'm not sure it can be captured, you know.
Mm.
Magic
yeah, yeah.
or whatever it
yeah.
is. I was telling you, people now in their 30s and 40s send me videos of themselves singing, and
yeah.
guys in Australia say, here we are, Tom, outside a bar in Canberra,
yeah.
and we're just thinking about when we were at school and they sing the skin of a rinky dinky dinky.
Yeah, yeah.
It's amazing. And a guy
yeah.
phoned me from Belfast there recently. He says, hi, Tom, my name is Paul, or his name was. Will you come and sing at my wedding? My fiance and I are big fans of yours as children.
Yeah.
I don't really do weddings, you know. I said, no, we want you to come to the chapel, and during the service, we want you to sing Skin of a Rinky Dinky Dink, I Love You. You know, it's so weird, like, and then...
And did you?
No, we did not. God, no, I'd be embarrassed. I would have embarrassed them as well. And then the guy, the head of the Students' Union at Queen's, phoned me about 4 or 5 years ago. He said, would you ever come up here and do a night at the Union? I said, well... What, maybe a folk music show? No. I said, your kids' shows.
Right.
That's a union. Well, I said, everyone knows you from when you were...
Yeah, primary schools.
All around the north, playing the schools. And he said, you would pack the hall. And he said, and you talk, said, they would all be half-jarred. And they would really sing.
Yeah.
And they all remember. The songs are very memorable, you know.
Yeah.
Tingaleo, Apples and Bananas.
Children are very unforgiving. They're a very cold audience if you don't catch them.
You're right. I remember this friend of mine, he said, well, you know, you've got a good market there. It's so easy doing kids' shows, you know. You should do it. And I was double booked. I have a gig, you want to go and play it? This particular gig, near here. He said, great. So I went out and they had, I don't know, 150 kids or whatever it was. But all the only songs you knew were off my record. He sang one of my songs. Yeah. All the kids are going, that's Tom's song. Four mazes, never again.
Yeah.
There's a certain, I don't know what it is, but...
Yeah.
But as you say, I mean, when I had suggested that you make a DVD and that, there's definitely nothing that can substitute, you know.
You know that yourself,
the
Jerry.
One-on-one
you work with children
with
as well, and Bob.
Yeah.
I mean, the one-on-one. And I was told you before, maybe this. I always talk about how what you do, what we all do. Mm-hmm. You don't know how it's going to affect someone because you go home, they go home. But what lasts, you do not know.
No, absolutely.
And I did a show one time somewhere, Ballymoney or somewhere, and I got a call that night about 7 o'clock in the evening from this mum. Are you Tom Sweeney? I'm going, what have I done now? And I said, I am, yes. Were you playing at such as a school today? I was, yeah. We said, when do you hear this? I said, I held the phone out. And this wee girl was singing her heart out, skin of a rinky dink, and said to me, this child is an elective mute. I have never heard her speak in my life.
Wow.
Ever. And she said, I can't get her to stop singing the song. So,
and that was the first time she'd heard her
voice.
Her
and whatever
voice,
effect
that
song, and that's unquantifiable.
You can't put a price on that, is it? No,
those things just happen, and I don't know how or why, but it moved me greatly.
Oh,
yeah. That I had that written down because I thought, if you don't mention that, I'm going to ask you to mention that, because
it's
that
very moving,
is
that
so
music
incredible.
Has that effect on people.
Yeah.
Well, it touches, you know, in special schools especially, with kids who can't communicate, it touches part of them that, as you say, we can't explain.
Yeah, that's right.
Before you sing another song, but you sing the lovely Mona Lisa, though, I do want you to tell us the story about the group of kids that you were singing to, and you seen a teacher take one of the children out.
Can I tell the story here? Can I tell the story?
I think you can.
I was doing that was 5 and 6 year olds up in somewhere County Down anyway. And I was Halloween, so I was telling not too scary, the wee ones, wee scary stories. You know. I told the story, and I can't remember what it was, but I'm telling the story, and I look at the kids, they're all looking at me like this, you know, and I'm looking at them. And I whatever the punchline was, I saw this wee girl leaving the hall with her teacher by the hand, you know.
Yeah.
I kept on saying, I was leaving the school, and I was walking up the corridor, and I met the same wee girl coming down. She goes, "Hey, you're the man who was singing this morning." That's right. I said, but you left and you never came back. She said, do you know what? I said, what? She said, I shit myself.
Love it.
And that was her exact, words. I laughed the whole way home.
Oh,
you know?
My God, I'm sure you
out
did.
Of the mouths of babes and innocents, you know.
The truth. Yeah. Thank you so much for coming on to the Culture Show.
It's my absolute pleasure. And what you do a great job here, you know. What this show is what this town needs, I think. Just,
thank you very much.
This town's so full of talent, you know.
Oh, huge.
And you guys are doing a great job in exposing it to everyone.
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you. And thank you for singing as well. And we're going to have you singing now. Mona Lisa, Mr. Tom Sweeney.
Mona Lisa, Mona Lisa, men have named you. You're so like the lady with the mystic smile. Is it only 'cause you're lonely they have blamed you for that Mona Lisa strangeness in your smile? Do you smile to tempt a lover, Mona Lisa?
hide a broken heart. Many dreams have been left at your doorstep. They just lie there and they die there. Are you warm? Are you real, Mona Lisa? Or just a cold and lonely, lovely work of art?
To hear Tom Sweeney do the two things that I know he does best, talking and singing. Are there others? Possibly he's smiling, maybe there is.
Let's sing a song, shall we?
We're down to our last two numbers of the Culture Show, so we'll keep things going with What a Difference a Day Made.
What a difference a day made, 24 little hours, brought the sun and the flowers, where there used to be rain. My yesterday was blue, dear, today I'm part of you, dear, my lonely nights are through, dear. What a difference a day makes. There's a rainbow before me. Skies above can't be stormy. Since that moment of bliss, that thrilling kiss, it's heaven when you find romance on your menu. What a difference a day made. And the difference is you. There's a rainbow before me. Skies above can't be stormy. Since that moment of bliss, that thrilling kiss, it's heaven when you find romance on your menu. What a difference a day made, and the difference is you. above can't bestow me. Since that moment of bliss, that thrilling kiss, it's heaven when you find romance on your menu. What a difference a day made, and the difference is you. What a difference a day made, and the difference is you. What a difference a day made, and the difference is you.
Thank you so much for joining us on The Culture Show. Thank you to our guest, Tom Sweeney, and to Danny McCormick for joining us on bass also. We have Stephen Crook's music doing our audio and sound. Thank you, Stephen.
Thank you.
And we are going to finish now with They Can't Take That Away From Me.
Bye.